All of us have 20,000 genes in our genome. Yet in our lifetime, fewer than 10% of these genes will ever be expressed. So what determines that 10%?
This is Dr. Pam Cantor. She studies the science of how kids learn and develop.
So much of who we become is because of the environments, experiences, and relationships that we are exposed to. That gene expression is our potential. This is what we could be if the context of our lives supported that expression to reveal itself.
So let me get this straight. What you're really saying here is that the environments, experiences, and relationships in our lives drive the expression of our genes?
Yes.
So is that good or bad news?
There's good and bad in that. If very positive things develop us in our families, in our schools, in our communities, we're going to influence that 10%. But if our lives are filled with adversity and stress, those incredible genes might not get expressed.
So Pam thinks this is a huge problem because so many of our kids walk into their learning environments with high levels of stress that we aren't addressing, which begs the question,
how much untapped potential are we leaving on the table?
This is Stand Together Presents, stories from the changemakers tackling society's biggest problems. So Pam's got a big idea, and that idea could challenge some of the most foundational problems within our education system. It's good stuff.
What we've done is believed that there are kids with better genes, that some kids grow up destined for greatness, and others just have less potential. This has been tremendously harmful to kids, and particularly kids from marginalized groups. And it doesn't add up at all to what we know to be true today.
So what does the brain and stress have to do with potential?
The brain is a deeply, deeply connected structure. The limbic system is the part of the brain that is centrally involved in learning and our emotions.
And this system is particularly sensitive to two hormones. The first is cortisol.
When we experience stress, cortisol is released through our bodies and our brains. Cortisol, in a certain amount, can help us be alert, sharp, prepare, and focus.
But too much cortisol can be a very bad thing.
It can actually cause the brain to get locked in that fight or flight feeling. It can really derail kids from concentration, focus, all the things that they need in order to be able to learn.
But the good thing is there is an antidote to stress, and it has to do with relationships.
One of the most amazing things is the human relationship. When relationships are consistent and caring, they cause the release of a hormone, oxytocin. It is known as the love hormone, and it can protect children from the damaging effects of cortisol. Very often the response to kids that are having this unregulated behavior because of stress is to punish them, to exclude them, and not to understand that everything that they're seeing is something that's entirely preventable.
So Pam and a group of colleagues have developed a strategy called Whole Child Design. It equips schools with resources that help foster positive growth.
Whole Child Design means doing these five things together. First and foremost, relationships that are strong and positive. Second, environments where children feel safe and that they belong. Third, there are rich, meaningful instructional experiences where children discover what they're capable of. Fourth, developing those 21st century skills, mindsets, and habits that all successful learners have. And fifth, lots of academic and emotional support. If you design for that, then you get experiences for kids that are going to unlock their belief and unlock their potential, their understanding of what they can become. We're talking about a very different design for a learning environment where relationships and the opportunity for the hormonal effects of oxytocin, belief in oneself, is happening because we've put relationships at the center of learning.
These may sound like simple concepts, but Pam thinks that doing these well in every school across the country could transform education, especially for students farthest from opportunity.
That's what Whole Child Design is all about. It is happening in some places, but it is not happening everywhere. We have a body of knowledge, but we really have to do it in every school for every child in America. That's the challenge today.
Thanks for watching. To learn more about the changemakers driving innovation in education, visit standtogether.org.